but I don't know if I wouldn't still be a performer. Because in this life, I love music, and music is my love. You know, it's all I know.
Marvin Gaye, born Marvin Pence Gaye Jr., was born on April 2nd, 1939, in Washington, District of Columbia, Maryland. The church minister, Marvin Gaye Sr., and mother, Alberta Gaye. His first home was in a public housing project, the Fairfax Apartments, now demolished. Marvin Gaye was raised under the strict authority of his father, Reverend Marvin Gaye Sr. Marvin Gaye Jr. added the E on the end of his name later in life. Gaye often found solace in music throughout his childhood and learned to play the piano and drums at an early age. His only singing experience prior to high school was in church revivals, but he quickly discovered a love for R&B and doo-wop. That would be the groundwork for his career. In the 1950s, Gaye joined a nationally known doo-wop group, the Moonglows, under the direction of Harvey Fuqua, one of the genre's foremost maestros, who then relocated the group to Chicago. When doo-wop dissipated in the late 1950s, Gaye had already absorbed Fuqua's lessons in close harmony. After disbanding the Moonglows, Fuqua took the 20-year-old Gaye to Detroit, where Berry Gordy Jr. was forming Motown Records. Gaye, who also played the drums and piano for Motown legends such as Little Stevie Wonder, The Supremes, The Marvelettes, and Martha and the Vandellas.
That's the first time you ever worked with a woman that size.
Oh, boy, a big one.
We were talking before about what people do before they end up doing what they're doing. Did you always study to be a singer?
Well, no, I never did. I always wanted to. I've never had any formal training insofar as singing is concerned.
When did you start wanting to be a performer?
All my life, Dick, really. I got the breaks. I was telling somebody the other day that it's maybe 20% talent nowadays and 80% luck.
I don't believe that.
You know? I didn't think it used to be, but I think nowadays with the market so technical and everything.
I think there's another percentage, and it's a thing called stick-to-itiveness. Luck of being there, but you work so hard so long to be in the right spot at the right time when the lightning strikes. Do you agree?
Well, I agree with that. I agree with that, but I don't know. I think you need so much luck, honest to God. I guess I just feel so lucky and blessed to have made a mark, some kind of mark, or some kind of little small dent in the business, and I feel so blessed and lucky that I just feel it's luck. I just do.
Blessed with an exceptionally wide range that encompassed three distinct vocal styles, a piercing falsetto, a smooth mid-range tenor, and a deep gospel growl, Gaye combined great technical prowess with rare musical individuality. Gaye's first certified hit under his own name wouldn't come until 1962, but his early years at Motown were full of behind-the-scenes successes, showing his stripes as Motown's Renaissance man. Gaye went on to break into the top 40 for the first time on his own in 1962 with his solo single, Hitchhike. Throughout the 1960s, Gaye would show his immense range, churning out solo dance hits and romantic duets with hitmakers like Diana Ross and Mary Wells. His break came with Stubborn Kinda Fella, 1962, the first of a long string of hits in the Motown mold, mainly songs written and produced by others, including I'll Be Doggone, 1965, by Smokey Robinson. And I Heard It Through the Grapevine, 1968, by Norman Whitfield. Gaye also enjoyed a series of successful duets, most notably with Tammy Terrell. For three high-flying years, Gaye and Tammy Terrell wowed the country with their soaring duet performances of songs like Ain't No Mountain High Enough and If I Could Build My Whole World Around You. Unfortunately, their reign as the royal couple of R&B ended when Terrell succumbed to a brain tumor in 1970. After his beloved partner's death, ushered in a dark period for the singer, who swore never to partner with another female vocalist and threatened to abandon the stage for good. In 1970, inspired by escalating violence and political unrest over the Vietnam War, Gaye wrote the landmark song, What's Going On? Despite clashes with Motown over the song's creative direction, the single was released in 1971 and became an instant smash.
I've heard so many of your albums. The one that I really have kept a fondness for through all these years is What's Going On. And I learned today that you consider that a concept album, as did I. Would you explain what you meant by that?
Well, when the world and, well, the state of the Union was, and, well, the Vietnamese War was raging hot and heavy during that period that we conceived it, and there was a lot of unrest in America. There were college kids being shot in campuses, and my brother was at war, and I prayed a lot that he would come through safely, and it was a very trying period for me at Motown, even.
It was with
the time
everyone.
I was struggling for some sort of independence and some sort of recognition as a producer and trying to let the artist in me come to forefront and not be produced.
What's Going On was a critical and commercial sensation in spite of the fact that Gordy, fearing its political content and its stand against the Vietnam War, had argued against its release. It included the chart-topping singles, What's Going On, Mercy, Mercy Me, Ecology, and Inner City Blues, Make Me Wanna Holler. The What's Going On album introduced Gaye to a new audience while keeping his Motown fan base. In October 1968, Gaye sang the national anthem in Detroit before Game 4 of the World Series between the Tigers and the Cardinals. He also sung the national anthem at the 1983 NBA All-Star Game. In 1969, Gaye made his acting debut playing the character David Owens alongside Lee Majors in the movie called The Ballad of Andy Crocker. In 1971, he also appeared in the action thriller Chrome and Hot Leather with William Smith. In 1972, Gaye moved to Los Angeles, where he was inspired in part by his newfound independence. Gaye recorded one of the most revered love anthems of all time, Let's Get It On. The song became his second number one Billboard hit, cementing his crossover appeal once and for all. Shortly afterwards, Motown pushed Gaye into touring to capitalize on his most recent success. Reluctantly, the singer-songwriter returned to the stage. Other major artists, most importantly Stevie Wonder, followed Gaye's lead and acted as producer, of their own efforts. In 1972, Gaye wrote the soundtrack for the film Trouble Man, with lyrics that mirrored his own sense of insecurity. Let's Get It On, released in 1973, displayed Gaye's sensuous side. I Want You in 1976 was another meditation on libidinous liberation.
Music has gone through how many phases, if you would group it?
Well, I don't know how many phases my music's gone through. I write my music according to my lifestyle. If I'm sad, I write sad music. If I'm being divorced, I write divorce albums. If I'm sexy, if I feel hot and no horny as I'm, I'll write a horny album.
Through most of the mid-1970s, Gaye was touring, collaborating, or producing. Working with Diana Ross and The Miracles, he put off releasing another solo album until 1976. He continued touring after the release of I Want You in 1976, and after scoring a number one hit in 1977 with the dance single Got to Give It Up, released his last album for Motown Records, Hear My Dear, in 1978.
I was undergoing two divorces during the same, and that's a bit of pressure. A lot of people probably think of that as running away from the situation. Well, a wise general, if he's a good general and a good tactician, is certainly familiar with the art of retreat and regrouping for a better fight, better day. I simply look at my departure as just such a thing, and I'm here for rearmed mentally, physically, and spiritually, and hopefully I'm ready for a better fight.
It was their fault. I'm a difficult person.
I admit that.
Did you try to make yourself a little bit more difficult so they would let you go?
Now, Boyd, that's rather incriminating in a way. But, perhaps.
Are there going to be lawsuits on your part against Motown?
No, not at this. Lawsuits. No. Normal, audits and things like that.
Normal audit. Do you feel that you haven't been paid what you deserve?
Now, Boyd, I never said that. And,
would you say it?
Would I? Yes, I would.
Do you feel freer now that you're not recording for Motown? Do you feel like you have
free? If I say yes, that would mean I felt locked up or somehow imprisoned or in bondage or something like that.
Well, not in bondage, but too much.
Yeah, bondage, we got to watch that word, yes. But the, yes, I do, frankly, feel freer. Yes, I was. In fact, yes, I did feel closed then and with nowhere to go. Yes, I did feel that I had outlived my usefulness for the company.
After two decades at Motown, Gaye left Motown and signed with CBS's Columbia Records in 1982 and began to work on his last album, Midnight Love. The lead single from that album, Sexual Healing, became a huge comeback hit for the R&B star and earned him his first of two Grammy Awards and an American Music Award for Favorite Soul Single. Despite his successful comeback in the early 1980s, Gaye struggled badly with the substance abuse and bouts of depression that had plagued him for most of his life.
Okay. What was the absolute rock bottom worst moment in the last 7 years?
Well, the absolutely worst rock bottom moment in the last 7 years when I tried to commit suicide through an overdose of cocaine.
How long ago was that?
It was not too long ago. Well, it was about 3 years ago in Hawaii. I was in an emotional state of, I've never been quite so depressed. I'm a bit of a manic depressant anyway.
most of the time. I put on quite a face and an act, but I'm pretty depressed most of the time. I have, as I said before, a lot of feeling inside for people and my love, my life, my job, what I feel I'm here for, my purpose. And I'm a little reluctant sometimes to get on with it. I'm afraid I'm much too emotional to be an artist, really, to be a really good one, to be on the job all the time. I guard my heart pretty well these days because I'm afraid if I ever fell in love again and I met the wrong woman, I don't imagine how I'll live. I have a very fragile heart. Now, I put on a pretty rough exterior, and it's pretty thick. But I imagine some lady will penetrate it again one day. I hope she's the right one. I was depressed because I was very much in love with my wife at the time, and I couldn't bear the thought of the rejection. My ego is much too too heavy, or whatever I want to say, too big, too wild, too whatever, to accept rejection. And I was rejected, and I had to learn the lessons of rejection, and it's done a great deal to heal my ego and to make me realize that I am probably not the king of the earth as I've always felt I was.
Is that what you're...
I'm now a prince.
Yeah. Is that what your mom told you when you were little, that you were...
No, it's interesting.
Better than the other kids?
No, she never did that. I never played with the other kids when I was a little boy. I didn't start playing with the kids until I was well in my teens. I was always a loner, which I guess is why I can grow and be alone now rather nicely without any too many problems.
The pain, for all of its awful moments, does it make the music better? Does it make the output better? Does it make the songs better?
Well, of course, if one wouldn't be, one could never be a fine artist if one hasn't lived and experienced most of life's negatives, I guess it's enough to say, and one would have to experience most of life positives also. You see, I guess I have gone from the depths of somewhat degradation to, I've probably risen to the heights of spirituality in some cases also. I felt nearly there spiritually sometimes, and I felt like the gates of hell were open for me at other times.
After his last tour, he moved into his parents' home. There, he and his father fell into a pattern of violent fights and quarrels that recalled conflicts that haunted the family for decades. On April 1st, 1984, Marvin Gaye Sr. shot and killed his son after a physical altercation. The father claimed he acted in self-defense, but would later be convicted of involuntary manslaughter.
Soul singer Marvin Gaye, whose career spanned over 25 years, including the birth of the Motown sound to the 80s, was shot to death yesterday in Los Angeles. Dick Shoemaker reports.
69-year-old Marvin Gaye Sr. was taken to police headquarters in downtown Los Angeles last night after being booked on suspicion of murder in the death of his son. Marvin Gaye was visiting his parents' home here in Los Angeles. There was a family argument. The singer was shot in the chest. A little while later, Marvin Gaye died.
Marvin Gaye Sr. armed himself with a handgun and fired several shots, wounding Marvin Gaye Jr. Marvin Gaye Jr. was taken to California Hospital, where he was pronounced dead from gunshot wounds at 1 o'clock this afternoon.
What can I say? It is a tragedy. I love Marvin, and I'm very sorry what happened.
Family and friends were shocked and wept openly in the wake of the killing, and a crowd gathered in front of the Gaye home. Police say the singer and his father started arguing over insurance matters Saturday night, resuming the argument Sunday. Marvin Gaye Sr. is expected to be arraigned sometime this week.
3 years after his death, Gaye was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He also received a Grammy Award for Lifetime Achievement in 1996, creating beautiful art from a troubled life. Gaye, again and again, brought his vision, range, and artistry to the world stage. At the end of his career, he admitted he no longer made music for pleasure. Instead, he said, "I record so that I can feed the people what they need and what they feel. Hopefully, I recorded it so that I can help someone overcome a bad time."
I want to stay with this music thing. It's the only thing for me, I think. It's just something I love, something that's a part of me every day, each and every hour. I really love it, and it's just what I love, you know, what I love. So I think I want to stick with it, and I want to do bigger and better things. The personal satisfaction is one of the few things that I think give you peace of mind in this business. When the hard things and the hardships and the panics and the button pushers and the screamers and everybody of this type, you sort of all sit back in your mind after you hear a great acceptance from an audience. And it's one of the few personal satisfactions that I think an artist gets in this business. I have my lonesome moments off stage, but those are the few moments that you feel that the whole world loves you.
Don't forget to comment below. Also like and subscribe to our channel. Thank you for watching.